Hello everyone, today I will talk about the neonatal resuscitation guideline according to American Heart Association 2015 guideline and what are the major changes between 2010 and 2015 NRP guideline. So first major change in 2015 is before the birth of the baby, three things we have to done. First is equipment should be checked before the birth of the baby. Second thing, antenatal counseling of the parents and caregivers should be done about the risk is present in the pregnancy. And the third thing, team briefing. So every person in the team who is going to resuscitate the baby should know their role in the resuscitation. So before the birth of the baby, we should check the equipment. So I will tell about the what are the equipments will be required for the resuscitation. So three warm, pre-warm towel will be required to dry up the baby and to cover the baby. And radiant warmer will be required to keep the baby warm. And then we will require the nasogastric feeding tubes of the size 5, 6, 7. We will require the endotracheal tube and laryngoscopes to intubate the baby. So endotracheal tube of the size of 2.5, 3, 3.5 and 4 will be needed. In endotracheal tube there are the three parts. One is endotracheal tube connector and this is tubing and this is the vocal cord. Black mark at the end of the tube is the vocal cord guide. So for the baby less than 1 kilogram weight, 2.5 size will be required. For the weight between 1 to 2 kilogram, 3 size will be required. For the weight between 2 to 3 kg, 3.5 size will be required. And for the more than 3 kg weight, 4 size will be required. And about the length, how much length should be inserted inside, we have the formula 6 plus weight. If the weight of the baby is 1 kilogram, then 6 plus 1, 7 centimeter. So 7 is marked over here. So we will insert up to 7 centimeter. Or we can also see the vocal cord guide, just cross the vocal cord. We have to fix at that level. So we can remember 7, 8, 9 formula. 7 for 1 kg weight, 8 for the 2 kg weight and 9 for the 3 kg. Or weight plus 6 will be the length inserted. And in laryngoscope, a straight blade will be required. So in blade size 00, it is mentioned over here, 00, 0 and 1 will be required. 00 for the extremely premature baby less than 1 kg and 0 for the preterm baby and 1 for the full term baby. And before resuscitation, we should check bulb is properly working and the battery is inside. So all these things should be checked before. Self-inflating brick should be checked before and the capacity of the brick between 250 to 750 ml. 250 ml brick capacity will be required for the extremely premature baby and for the full-term baby 500 and 750 ml brick capacity will be needed. And the pop-off wall should be checked before the birth of the baby. So make the fist of the palm and hold the mask in this way and press the bed. So pop-off wall should be elevated when you are pressing the bed. So it is working properly. And the oxygen tubing to connect over the oxygen inlet and reservoir to be connected over here. So if you will not connect the oxygen and the reservoir, then 21% oxygen will be delivered to the baby. If we will connect the oxygen tubing only, not reservoir, then up to 40% oxygen will be delivered to the baby. If we will connect the oxygen tube and reservoir both, then up to 100% oxygen can be delivered to the baby. A mask of the various sizes should be available. So in this small, medium and large size mask should be there. For extremely premature baby, we will need the small size mask and for the preterm, medium and for the full term, large size mask will be required. Then the adhesive will be required to fix the endotracheal tube and IV cannula and umbilical venous catheter. Sterile seizure, autoclave seizure will be required to cut the tape, and if ET is long enough, suction catheter of various size 8, 10, 12 and 14 French will be required. So 8 and 10 for the preterm baby, 12 for the full term baby and 14 for the meconium stent baby. And suction catheter should be fixed to the suction machine, either portable suction machine or the wall mounted suction machine, and suction pressure should be set 80 to 100 mmHg before the delivery of the baby. Not more than 100 mmHg pressure should be there. And the adrenaline, 1 milligram adrenaline in 1 ml, 1 is to 1000 diluted. We have to make the 1 is to 10,000 diluted adrenaline. So take the 1 ml of adrenaline and 9 ml NS, 1 is to 10,000 dilution will be there. Pre-filled syringe should be prepared before. So dose of the adrenaline is 0.01 to 0.03 milligram per kilogram intravenously. We can give either by the umbilical venous catheter or IV cannula. If not possible to insert the IV line, then endotracheally also 0.05 to 0.1 milligram per kilogram 1 to 10,000 diluted adrenaline can be given. And the syringes of various size 2, 5, 10, 20 and 50 ml will be required. Umbilical cord clamp should be there. And shoulder roll should be prepared before to elevate the shoulder and keep the baby in sniffing position. And ECG monitor, 3-lead ECG monitor will be required for the heart rate monitoring. So these are the things, and pulse oximeter with the neonatal probe, so to monitor the preductal SpO2. So before the birth, three things should be done. Equipment should be checked, antenatal counseling of the parents and caregiver, and the third thing, team briefing. For the normal delivery and LSCS, if there is no risk, then one skilled person will be required for the neonatal resuscitation. If there is a risk in the mother, example, if mother is suffering from the diabetes, hypertension, eclampsia, or having placenta, abruptio placenta, then we will label as a high-risk pregnancy, or we are thinking twins delivery is going to be, or preterm delivery, again we will label high-risk pregnancy. So in the high-risk pregnancy, at least two skilled persons should be available for the neonatal resuscitation, and for the complete neonatal resuscitation, we will require three or more persons. So this is the one major change before birth, three things should be done. Second major change is, for the preterm baby, we will start the resuscitation, positive pressure ventilation with 21 to 30% FiO2, and for the full term baby with 21% FiO2, which is not mentioned in the 2010 guideline. And third thing, whenever preterm baby is delivered and having the respiratory distress, labored breathing less than 35 weeks of the gestation age, put the baby on continuous positive airway pressure in the labor room, which is not mentioned in the 2010 guideline. Fourth change is, in 2010, it's a compulsory thing to intubate the meconium stent baby. Non-vigorous meconium stent baby should be intubated and tracheal suction should be done. But in 2015 guideline, it is removed that no need to do the tracheal suctioning. And the fifth and last one is, for heart rate, we should put the ECG monitor, and heart rate should be monitored by the ECG, 3-lead ECG. Clinical assessment sometimes wrong, so that's why they have implemented the ECG monitor. So these things is already done before birth of the baby. Now whenever baby is delivered, then three questions we have to ask. Is the baby's term having the good muscle tone, and baby is breathing or crying? If anyone is no, baby is not tum, not crying or not breathing and not having the good muscle tone, then we will start the initial steps of resuscitation. If answer to all these questions is yes, baby is strong, having good muscle tone and crying well and breathing well, then we will start the routine care. So in routine care, we will provide the warmth to the baby by keeping the baby on the mother's abdomen in prone position and cover the baby by a towel from backside. And by this position, secretions will be cleared spontaneously. If secretions are there and we require the suction, then we can do, but not in all babies. And baby should be dry. This is the routine care: warm position, clear the secretion, and dry up the baby. And if the answer to any one of the question is no, then we will start the initial steps of resuscitation. So what are those initial steps? These are the 5 initial steps of resuscitation. Keep the baby under radiant warmer. Radiant warmer should be on before receiving the baby, and room temperature of the labor room should be 26 to 28 degrees centigrade. And so provide the warmth. Then second thing is position the baby in sleeping position. Do not flex the head, do not hyperextend the head. It should be in sleeping position. So for maintaining the sleeping position, we will require the shoulder roll. So keep the shoulder roll under the shoulders and put the baby in sleeping position. So pharynx, larynx and trachea will be in straight line. Third thing, suction the oral cavity first, then nose. So for suctioning, we have to use the suction catheter of the proper size for preterm baby 8 and 10 and for full term 12 size. And always remember, oral cavity first, then nose. So whatever oral secretions are present should be cleared before suctioning the nose. If we will suction the nose first, then whatever secretion is present in oral cavity will be aspirated by the baby and the baby will worsen. And do not go for the deep suctioning. If you will go for the deep suctioning and if the catheter will touch the posterior pharyngeal wall, then vagal nerve will be stimulated and baby will develop the bradycardia and apnea. So always remember, suction should be very gentle, not should be deep and nice. So after suctioning, you have to dry up the baby. So for drying, you have to remove the all weight lines of the baby by pre-warm towel. Then remove the weight towel and keep the baby on another pre-warm towel. So after drying, if still baby is not showing any breathing, then stimulate the baby. So for stimulation, either you have to rub the back or the trunk 1 or 2 times, or flick the sole 1 or 2 times, and again reposition the baby in sleeping position. So after these 5 initial steps of resuscitation, we have to again check the heart rate, respiratory rate and SpO2. So I will revise again. Initial steps: keep the baby warm under radiant warmer, position the baby in sleeping position and suction the oral cavity, then nose, and then dry up the baby well. And fifth thing, stimulate the baby and again reposition the baby. After all these 5 initial steps, we have to evaluate the baby by heart rate, respiratory rate and SpO2. If heart rate is less than 100 beat per minute and baby is not breathing and crying and SpO2 is not improving, so after 30 seconds, these initial steps should be completed within 30 seconds of the birth. We will start the bag and mask ventilation. So for bag and mask ventilation, positive pressure ventilation, hold the mask, proper size mask, between the thumb and index finger. Keep over the nose and the mouth. It should cover the mouth and nose both. It should not cover the eyes. It should not recede the chin. And press tightly, so tight seal should be there. And keep your middle finger and the ring finger over the submental area to keep the mouth open. And Praise the bag. Breathe 2, 3. Breathe 2, 3. So by this way, we will create the PIP, positive inspiratory pressure, of 20 to 30 mmHg. And rhythm should be followed. Breathe 2, 3. So whenever we are saying breathe, we have to praise the bag. And whenever we are saying 2, 3, release the bag. So at least 40 to 60 breathe per minute should be delivered to the baby by this way. Breathe 2, 3. Breathe 2, 3. And we will start the positive pressure ventilation with 21% oxygen. And after 15 seconds, we have to again evaluate for the heart rate, respiratory rate and the SpO2. And if heart rate is improving, increasing, and the SpO2 is improving, that means effective positive pressure ventilation is delivered to the baby, then continue the positive pressure ventilation. If the during this spontaneous respiration has started but baby is having the labored breathing and central sinuses is there, then we will keep the baby on the free flow of oxygen either by the tube, tronx, mask, or if the baby is preterm, then on CPAP. And again, after full 30 seconds of positive pressure ventilation with the self-inflating bag, if baby is not showing increased heart rate and respiration has not improved and SpO2 is not at between 60 to 65% at the 1 minute, then we will increase the FiO2 concentration and we will connect the ECG monitor also to monitor for the ECG heart rate, and we will follow the effective ventilation. Still not showing the effective ventilation, then ventilatory corrective step should be taken. So for the ventilatory corrective step, we have the trick MR SOPA. M4 mask should be adjusted well, so it should be sealed enough so air should not leak from the mask. Then R4 reposition the baby, and O4 open the mouth by giving the mental thrust. S4 secretion, clear the secretion. P4 increase the pressure of the bag. So generally whenever we are pressing, it creates the PIP of 20 to 30. If we require more pressure, we have to press it well. If you are using the TP's resuscitator, then you can increase the PIP up to 40. So MR SOPA, M for the mask adjustment, R for the reposition, S for the secretion should be clear, and O4 open the mouth, P4 increase the pressure, and A4 alternative way to give the effective ventilation. So if not showing any improvement after the ventilatory corrective step, then we will intubate the baby. So for the intubation, we will require the laryngoscope and the ET tube. So laryngoscope should be pulled into the left hand, and baby should be in sniffing position, and by the laryngoscope we will lift the tongue, and then structure epiglottis will be visible. We will elevate the epiglottis also, and then esophagus is the round structure will be visible when we are inserting the laryngoscope. Then we have to give the upward thrust to the laryngoscope, so the vocal cord will be visible. If it's still not visible, we will give the cricoid pressure with the help of another person, and we will insert the ET tube in this way. And after inserting the ET tube into the vocal cord, either vocal cord guide should cross the vocal cord, or you can remember the formula, weight plus 6 lens should be inserted, and ET tube should be fixed between the thumb and the index finger in this way. Keep the thumb over the head and the tube should be in middle and should be fixed with the index finger. Then we have to check ET is properly inserted or not. So for this, connect the and intubation should be completed within 30 seconds. It should not be more than 30 seconds. If you are not able to insert the ET within 30 seconds, then again ventilate the baby. Again, you can try or you can use the laryngeal mask airway if the weight of the baby is more than 1.5 kg. So for checking the ET tube is correctly inserted or not, there are the five things by which we can check. One is either see the chest movement when you are giving the tube and bag ventilation. If chest movements are there, that means ET is properly inserted. Second thing, auscultate the baby for breathing. You require the at least 2 or 3% for the resuscitation, so you will continue the resuscitation and second person will do the other things to auscultate for the heart rate and for the baby. So you have to press and you have to auscultate in axillary area for the airway, air entry is present or not. If bilateral air entry is there, that means tube is inserted properly. The third thing, you can see the when baby is exhaling, vapor inside the tube will be visible. So if there is a vapor inside the tube, that means tube is inserted into the trachea. And heart rate and SpO2 will improve with giving the tube and bag ventilation. Or we can use the CO2 monitor or capnogram. We will connect the CO2 monitor and capnogram over here and the color code will be changed in CO2 detector and the in capnography also graph will be visible. So by these five things, chest movement, air entry bilaterally, vapor inside and the heart rate and SpO2 will be improved, or by the capnography or CO2 detector we can check ET is properly inserted or not. So after tube and bag ventilation, again we have to check the heart rate by the ECG monitor, respiratory rate and the SpO2 by the pulse oximeter. So if baby is showing improvement, then we will continue the tube and bag ventilation till the baby will start spontaneous breathing. If baby is not showing any improvement and heart rate is going down less than 60 per minute, then we will start the chest compression. And for chest compression, there are the two techniques. One is the two thumb technique, in which we will keep the thumb below the nipple over the area of lower sternum. It should be above the xiphoid process in this way, and we will press the 1/3 of the chest in this way, and this will increase the cardiac contractility and coronary perfusion. We know baby is suffering from hypoxic manifestation, so myocardial ischemia and hypoxic damage to the myocardium occur, so baby will not be able to get the proper cardiac output, so baby can require the chest compression. So this is the one technique. This is the best technique and better technique. If we are not having the second person and we have to do the both thing, tube and bag ventilation and chest compression both, then we will use the two finger technique. In this we will keep the finger at the lower sternum and middle and index finger, and we will press in this way. At least 1/3 of the chest should be pressed, and the chest compression and tube and bag ventilation should be go simultaneously. So chest compression and the positive pressure ventilation will go simultaneously. For this we will follow the rhythm 1 and 2 and 3 and breath in, 1 and 2 and 3 and breath in. So 120 events in 1 minute. So every 2 seconds, 3 compression and 1 breathing will be delivered to the baby. And chest compression and positive pressure ventilation at least continue for 1 minute or more than 1 minute. Should not be stopped in between, because it's mentioned that the cardiac contractility and the perfusion will be improved only when we will continue the chest compression for full 1 minute. And after giving the chest compression, in between every 30 seconds we have to monitor the baby for heart rate, respiratory rate and the SpO2. If baby is showing the improvement and heart rate improve more than 60, then we will discontinue the chest compression and positive pressure ventilation will be continued till the breathing will be started. If still heart rate is less than 60 after 1 minute of chest compression and positive pressure ventilation, then we will require the third person to give the to insert the umbilical venous catheter and give the adrenaline injection. So for this we have prepared the pre-filled syringe, and if the weight of the baby is 3 kg, then 0.3 ml of 1:10 diluted adrenaline will be given through the umbilical venous catheter. So with chest compression and positive pressure ventilation, we will give the intravenous adrenaline. This should be continued simultaneously, it should not be stopped. Again we have to monitor the baby every 15 seconds. If baby is showing any improvement, then okay. If baby is not showing any improvement, then again we can repeat the adrenaline injection. If after that also baby is not showing any improvement, then think about the hypovolemia and the pneumothorax. If you are suspecting hypovolemia, then give the normal saline 10 ml per kg, or we can give the O negative blood transfusion 10 ml per kg if there is a history of blood loss in the form of if mother is suffering from placenta previa abruptio, and if you are suspecting the pneumothorax, then treat this. So there are 4 things, A, B, C, D. A for when we are doing the initial steps of resuscitation, 5 initial steps, provide the warm, position the baby, clear the secretions, triage the baby and stimulate. This is airway. B for when baby is not breathing and we are giving the positive pressure ventilation, this is B. And C for chest compression, when baby is not showing any improvement in the heart rate and heart rate goes down less than 60 and we are giving the chest compression with the positive pressure ventilation, then this is C. If still baby is not improving and we are giving the drug adrenaline, then this is D. So these are the ABCD algorithm of the neonatal resuscitation. Thank you.